teacher say that I'm the commandant here, you should go back to the campus. But we don't go back to campus. Some of our demonstration is just like a real war. We fight against the military for 24 hours and they shoot us with rifle butts and bayonets, and we throw them with stones.
Jadi tidak ada hadiah perubahan dari rejim Soeharto atau rejim Habibie yang ada saat ini. Yang ada perubahan hanya akan terjadi kalau rakyat mau melakukan perubahan itu sendiri gitu.
Hai rekan-rekanku, kita akan balas, kita akan menyingkirkan orang-orang yang seperti yang di dalam itu. Apalagi ada yang telah menggerogoti kita.
And then they point out something cool in my head, and I say, "Do you know what is this?" And I say, "Yes, I know. What's that?" "That's the gun." I say like that. "Oh, so you know, and you'll die if you tell lie later."
Terus mereka ikat kaki saya, kemudian mereka rapatkan paha saya, mereka letakkan stick strum itu di antara dua paha saya, kemudian dia hidupkan sampai kemudian saya jatuh ke belakang, lalu mereka pegang saya dengan 4 orang, mereka mulai siksa lagi, kemudian mereka juga menyetrum seluruh badan saya termasuk alat kelamin saya dan bagian apa leher saya dan kepala saya. Lalu mereka memaki-maki, "Kamu ini yang mau melawan Soeharto, bajingan, anjing, kera," macam-macam mereka sebutkan untuk saya.
ABRI itu sudah terlalu sudah terlalu dalam sekali terlibat mempertahankan satu sistem yang sangat korup ya. Sejak 65 pun sudah jutaan orang dibunuh.
Para jenderal juga adalah kapitalis-kapitalis. Kemudian bahkan pada tingkat kolonel mereka juga mempunyai alat-alat produksi sendiri, menjadi presdir di berbagai perusahaan. Jika ada tekanan, jika ada perlawanan dari rakyat, jika ada usaha untuk melawan terhadap struktur modal ini, mereka akan gunakan tentara. Mereka akan mengawasi, mereka mengintimidasi, mereka akan menteror, mereka akan menculik, mereka akan membunuh.
During the Soeharto dictatorship, the regime developed a doctrine which assigned the military a dual function in society. This doctrine justifies ABRI as having both a defensive function as well as a social political function.
Inilah akibat dari ABRI masuk dalam politik. Di fungsi ABRI ini memungkinkan ABRI itu masuk dalam kehidupan sipil dari tingkat nasional sampai ke tingkat RT. Mereka bisa setiap saat mengintimidasi, mereka bisa setiap saat mengawasi aktivitas politik sipil. Dan ini memberatkan gitu loh. bagi kehidupan sipil.
Tapi yang benar kamu ngomong.
Alhamdulillah.
Jangan seenaknya aja.
Terima kasih, Pak.
Saya juga mengamankan Anda. Hati nurani saya sudah terwakili oleh Anda.
Maka itu syarat utama dari demokrasi, syarat utama dari kebebasan perubahan itu adalah di fungsi ABRI ini dicabut. Gitu. Ini poin yang paling strategis. Ini adalah kunci buat demokrasi. Jika masih ada ini, tidak ada demokrasi. Jika masih ada ini, tidak ada reformasi. Jika tidak ada ini, tidak ada revolusi.
In August 1998, in Solo, Central Java, a strike occurred at a textile factory that employed 8,000 workers. The workers were demanding a 15% pay rise, a rise actually decreed by Suharto as compensation for the decrease in value of wages due to the economic crisis. This employer, like most others in Indonesia, refused to pay. When the workers took strike action, they were sacked. A picket was then set up outside the factory. Siding with the owners, the military stationed its troops inside and outside the factory. Violent clashes often occurred between the military and the workers.
Bahwa seluruh elemen masyarakat sekarang lebih melihat gerakan buruh adalah gerakan reformasi paling besar. Seluruh elemen rakyat, buruh dan mahasiswa terutama telah menyatukan diri dalam satu elemen koalisi demokratik untuk melawan rejim-rejim orde baru yang kapitalis.
Rekan-rekanku sekalian yang di sini, relakah kalian diinjak-injak, diperas, ditindas? Bagus! Kita solidkan diri kita masing-masing, himpun kekuatan, satukan, rapatkan, maju!
Bersatu dalam kapitalisme, buruh bersatu.
With no resolution after 2 weeks, 800 of the striking workers traveled to Jakarta to take their case to the Minister of Labour. On the way to the ministry, the police and military attacked. Eight workers were seriously injured and had to be hospitalised. After fruitless discussions with the Minister of Labour, they proceeded to occupy the ministry for 3 days. They were joined by hundreds of activists from Jakarta. Defying the military, they marched up the road for a fiery rally at the PDI office, the site of the 1996 military attack on Megawati's supporters. 1998 saw many similar worker actions occur throughout Indonesia. Workers who were no longer prepared to bow down to the repressive forces of the military.
Dan ini yang akan mengubah sejarah peradaban bangsa Indonesia, karena keselamatan itu ada di tangan masyarakat sipil yang sekarang sudah belajar banyak dari politik abuse moral, politik penggelapan fakta, politik kambing hitam.
semacam kita ini dalam hidup 32 tahun di menari-nari di atas karpet pembangunan ekonomi yang berkiblatkan pada pertumbuhan ekonomi, sehingga ketika karpet itu dibuka, tampaklah sampah-sampah penderitaan masyarakat yang luar biasa.
Because of the corruption, collusion, and nepotism associated with Suharto, the 1997 Asian economic crisis hit Indonesia particularly hard. Until the crisis, the international banks, the IMF and the World Bank were praising Suharto's miracle economy. But through the mismanagement of many of the businesses owned by Suharto and his crony friends, who relied on their monopoly in the Indonesian economy, inefficiencies and distortions existed. This resulted in large-scale capital flight and a massive devaluation of the rupiah. International capital came into direct conflict with national capitalist interests, and the IMF insisted on big policy changes that included further deregulation and privatization of the economy. Workers were forced to bear the burden of the crisis. Wages were slashed. Over one-third of our industry closed down, causing mass unemployment. More than 40% of the population now live in extreme poverty, with many more at risk.
Kesalahan manajemen sakit jiwa politik kekuasaan dalam mengelola manajemen negara dan bangsa ini, mereka ini adalah bisa kita lihat seperti kelompok anak-anak jalanan, street children, dan anak-anak perkampungan kumuh. Jumlahnya sekarang meningkat mungkin 40-50% dari tahun ke tahun. Di Jakarta saja, ketiadaan pekerjaan karena orang tuanya di PHK, karena orang tuanya digusur, lingkungan habitatnya digeser-geser ke sana kemari.
The IMF, an instrument of international capital, especially the big US banks, stepped in offering Indonesia a financial bailout package with conditions attached.
IMF merupakan salah satu alat penekan untuk negara-negara yang sedang membangun.
Heard the voice like the whip, da 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 da, and I thought that it was a whip they used to whip us. Maybe that's in my imagination at the time, and I'll die here.
As the movement opposing the Suharto New Order regime gathered momentum, the military resorted to desperate actions to quell the rising radical movement. In March, they kidnapped 23 student and political activists, subjecting them to torture, beatings, interrogation, and prison.
The first question they asked to me is, do you know Nesar Patria? He said like that, and I say, I don't know him. And then they beat me on my stomach and also on my face many times.
They targeted those activists at the grassroots level, who were organizing the students and workers. Many were leading members of the People's Democratic Party, the PRD.
First, they also asked me about Daniel Indrakusuma. Where is Daniel Indrakusuma? And I say, I don't know him. I have just arrived from Jogja. And then they used the stick to shock my feet. So at the time, I just realized that the sound, which is ta-da, 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 was the electric shock. They used to shock me. Because every time they shock me, I heard that voice, that sound, ta-da,
ta-da, ta-da. 14 of the kidnapped are still missing. One is known to be dead. Relatives are gravely concerned for the safety.
Penjahat-penjahat politik, beberapa orang atau ratusan orang yang bertanggung jawab terhadap pelanggaran hak asasi pada masa, terutama pada masa rejim Orde Baru.
There are over 90 million workers in Indonesia. More than 38 million have lost their jobs since the economic crisis. US companies like Nike and Reebok, along with companies owned by the richest Indonesian capitalists, all continue to make super profits. Yet workers are barely paid enough to survive. As a result, living conditions are appalling. Any attempts by workers to organize are crushed by the military, and disappearances and murders occur regularly.
Yang kita ajukan adalah kenaikan upah buruh itu 100%, UMR 100%. Terus kemudian stop intervensi militer, stop PHK. Itu yang utama ya.
Lukman, a member of the PRD, has been organizing workers in Indonesian factories since he left high school.
Dan selama 2 tahun itu saya menemukan apa arti perjuangan itu setelah kami melakukan mogok kerja di pabrik tahun 94. Dan situ terus kemudian ada intimidasi dengan gas air mata, ada yang pingsan teman-teman saya. Nah itu, aku semakin yakin bahwa perjuangan buruh itu nggak bisa dihentikan walaupun ada tekanan dari militer gitu.
Suharto controlled the political life of the country so tightly that no independent trade union or workers' associations were tolerated. Regardless, many workers took part in strike action and attempted to set up independent trade unions. One of these, the Indonesian Center for Labor Struggle, the PPBI, played a key role in mobilizing workers.
Pada tahun 94, 23 November, PPBI melakukan kongres dan saya dipercaya untuk menjadi pengurus pusat. Dan terus perjalanan saya di PPBI ini, pengalaman saya pertama di GRI. Itu sebuah pabrik besar dengan buruhnya 13.000, itu melakukan aksi mogok dan PPBI waktu itu langsung memimpin di sana. Itu terus saya ditangkap bersama Dita dan aktivis SMIT lainnya. Ada 7 orang waktu itu. Dan kami sempat menginap lebih dari 38 jam di sana di Bogor. Karena terus kami dilepas karena ada desakan dari teman-teman guru-guru GRI yang melakukan aksi di DPR RI pusat gitu, sampai menduduki gedung parlemen di sana.
Reformasi yang membakar sanubari sebagian besar rakyat di Indonesia yang dimotori oleh gerakan-gerakan demonstrasi damai mahasiswa.
...1998 was a year where the pent-up anger and frustration of the Indonesian people could no longer be contained. Decades of brutal oppression boiled over in the mass student protests, spontaneous rioting and looting all over the country. armed only with stones. Tens of thousands of students dared to raise their voices, dared to go out onto the streets to protest their opposition to the Suharto dictatorship.
Jadi pada tanggal 2 April kemudian tanggal 13 April kita sudah beberapa kota sering berkumpul untuk membahas lebih jauh bagaimana merancang sebuah strategi yang lebih serius ke depan. Dan kesimpulan kita adalah bahwa tidak ada aksi damai lagi. Ketika rakyat harus dilatih untuk melawan, dia harus diajari untuk melawan bila perlu dengan perjuangan bersenjata sekalipun gitu.
On May 12, when students from the Trisati University marched onto the streets from the campus, the military opened fire. Four students were killed and hundreds wounded. Angered by the killings, mass rioting broke out, lasting several days.
The students and people unite, and the pinnacle was on 20 of May. Over 1 million people of Yogyakarta marched to the center of the city, led by the Sultan Hamengkubuwono X. From this, people derive courage and the belief that the victory can be found if we are united.
Unable to bear the constraints any longer, and after months of street protests, Indonesian students rose up, faced the military guns, and brought down the dictator.
Oleh karena itu, daripada atau ketimbang gerakan ini meninggi dalam arti kualitasnya, maka lebih baik dia mundur dengan seperangkat persiapan-persiapannya.
People say it is a May revolution, but we don't think it's a revolution. We think it's student revolution, not the people revolution. We want every people element in Indonesia take part participate in this movement.
Memang kekuatan-kekuatan oposisi itu tambah lama tambah besar tumbuh ya, terutama dari generasi muda. Itu hanya satu faktor yang menjatuhkan Suharto. Faktor lain yang barangkali ini lebih banyak menentukan adalah kesalahan demi kesalahan yang dilakukan oleh Suharto sendiri. Dia menjadi tidak kenal batas terhadap segala apa, sikap-sikap, mengenai sikap-sikap represifnya, mengenai keserakahannya. Dan faktor ketiga saya kira faktor internasional yang selama ini mendukung dia, maksud saya modal besar ya, the big capital itu memang menjadi pendukung sejak awal dan sampai saat terakhir pun sebenarnya masih ingin mendukung dia, akan tetapi mereka akan mengalami kesulitan kalau terus-menerus mendukung dia. Jadi ada tiga faktor. Kalau Anda bertanya-tanya mengapa dia tidak pada saat oposisi ini bangkit, mengapa dia tidak gunakan kebiasaan-kebiasaannya untuk memukul kembali ya dengan senjata, saya pikir memang dia mempunyai masalah-masalah internal ya. Pertama ingin saya mengatakan bahwa faktor ABRI ya, tentara yang selama ini menjadi pendukung yang masif sekali, ya, yang loyal sekali terhadap dia, saya kira 5 tahun terakhir sudah memerateli. Itu tidak solid lagi, tidak monolit satu kesatuan yang apa, yang bulat mendukung dia. Sudah mulai di dalam ABRI sendiri timbul sikap-sikap mandiri. Ya. Mereka tidak mengkhianati Soeharto, tidak. Tapi mereka mulai prosesnya itu mulai mendistansi diri dari Soeharto. Ingin bersikap mandiri, tapi tetap loyal. Ya. Dan ada faktor modal yang selama ini, modal besar itu, sebutlah dengan istilah eufemisme mereka disebut apa, kekuatan globalisasi itu kapitalisme itu sebenarnya, itu tidak bisa atau sulit mentolerir, ya, Soeharto bekerja sama dengan Islam. Kekuatan modal ini, ya, ada dua kekuatan yang tidak bisa mereka tolerir, komunisme dan Islam. Komunisme dan Islam. Dan mereka ketemukan alternatif, tentara, ya, militer. Out, seorang jenderal juga naik, Soeharto. Inilah yang mereka dukung, sampai satu waktu, kekuatan yang mendukung dia ini, akhirnya sulit mentolerir terus-menerus. Pertama, karena dia korup tidak kepalang tanggung dengan seluruh keluarga dan kronisnya, ya, menyulitkan modal itu. Ya. Ini faktor-faktor saya pikir yang menyebabkan Soeharto jatuh.
Peristiwa 17 Agustus tahun 1945 yang lalu, yang sampai hari ini kita belum merdeka. Hidup rakyat!
Habibie government is just a Soeharto with another face. So it means that Soeharto has gone, but the regime is still there.
Kita tidak berada di dalam periode pasca Soeharto sekarang. Kita masih di dalam periode Soeharto tanpa Soeharto. Sehingga kekuatan Soekarno, institusi-institusinya, orang-orangnya, itu masih tetap ada dan masih pegang kekuasaan.
Habibie has continued to operate with exactly the same political structure. The only real concession he has made has been to reduce the military presence in parliament from 75 to 38. However, within Habibie's cabinet, there are more military officers than there were in the previous 2 Soeharto cabinets.
Maupun dengan menggusur atau menekan simbol-simbol gerakan perlawanan, gerakan oposisi dari masyarakat.
Dia tidak punya daya berat politis. Dia anak emas Soeharto.
Pramudia Anantatur, a writer and outspoken critic of the Soeharto regime, experienced firsthand Soeharto's brutality. In October 1965, Pramudia was beaten, tortured, and jailed for 14 years without ever going to trial.
Semua produk politis Orde Baru saya tidak bisa mempercayai, walaupun orang-orangnya berganti, tapi Orde Barunya sendiri masih tetap.
Di zaman Habibie, penembakan terhadap buruh Kerawang, Kerawang, Bekasi.
Far from being the reformer he claims to be, it is clear by his actions that Habibie endorses the politics of Suharto. The attack on the PDI office in July 1996 was one of Suharto's most recent violent actions in a long line of historical repressive measures against the Indonesian people. This attack to remove Megawati as head of the officially recognized PDI was a clear attempt to fragment the opposition. Despite this, however, Megawati remained a popular leader.
Itu dosa Suharto yang paling kotor, yang paling prinsipil secara politik. Sebab itu menyangkut pemerkosaan hak asasi, menyangkut pemerkosaan kedaulatan rakyat. Habibie ternyata mengendorse politik itu sampai sekarang.
One of the consequences of the military attack on the PDI office was 3 days of spontaneous rioting and looting by the urban poor. The regime blamed the riots on the PRD, who just weeks before had launched itself publicly as a political party. Suharto immediately banned it and ordered a military crackdown. Members of the PRD were hunted down by the military.
Selalu ada usaha juga yang disebut penggelapan fakta dan politik kambing hitam dan Budiman beserta teman-teman.
Sandy Awan, a Catholic priest, secretly hid Budiman Sujumiko, the PRD chairperson, and others from the military authorities.
Tentu saja pada saat itu saya tidak ragu-ragu untuk menolong mereka, apalagi ada demikian banyak ratusan yang ditangkap, justru mereka yang diserbu malah ditangkap. 11 atau 10 hari kemudian mereka tertangkap di tempat kakak saya bersama kakak saya Benny Sumardi, dan mereka dibawa ke barak Badan Intelijen ABRI BIA di Pasar Minggu, juga mengalami penyiksaan saya tahu. Kemudian mereka dibawa ke di Kejaksaan Agung untuk ditahan. Sementara di luar sendiri, saya tahu ada pembohongan yang besar dengan tuduhan-tuduhan stigmatisasi politik bahwa waktu itu saya ingat ada kebulatan tekad untuk mengganyang PRD bagaikan PKI pada zaman dahulu.
14 PRD members were tried for subversion and all received jail sentences.
Memang yang sangat disayangkan adalah justru Budiman waktu itu langsung meroket baik namanya maupun citranya sebagai alternatif pemimpin orang muda saat itu, dicecar sehingga dia kena 13 tahun.
On August 17, 1998, while Indonesia celebrated Independence Day, the PRD and East Timorese activists held a peaceful demonstration outside Cipinang Prison, where Budiman and Shanana Gusmao, along with many other political prisoners, were jailed. Budiman and Shanana addressed the demonstration from the balcony of the prison.
Terus menyekap kawan-kawan sepuluh kita di tangan para penculik. Kita kontinua. Terima kasih. Apol dan apol.
gap sosial ekonomi antara kaya dan miskin karena akibat dari penjarahan konstitusional selama rejim Orde Baru. Banyak rakyat menjadi miskin. Seakan-akan kemiskinan itu sebab utama dari kerusuhan. Yang kedua, konflik antar etnis. Persoalan rasisme itu dilebih-lebihkan. Seakan-akan akar dari seluruh persoalan state violence adalah pertarungan antar etnis.
The government has scapegoated the Chinese population, sending in provocateurs to stir up attacks against them. Chinese women were also targeted, and many were raped during the rioting in May.
Not all the riots and lootings are spontaneous. Now, when if we talk about the spontaneous riots, they tend to actually be aimed at police stations, army depots, government offices. And on the ways, maybe the big Chinese banks, the Chinese-owned banks, although then we have to be careful. All the Chinese-owned banks have some sort of family or crony shares in it. So, I mean, you can't really talk about Chinese banks. Those are spontaneous riots. Now, if you see that many Chinese property, Chinese shops, for example, or malls are being attacked, that is usually provoked. Now, the policy of the New Order especially has been to ghettoize the Chinese in the economic sector so that they can be scapegoated whenever it's necessary, so that the people, the masses, will not attack the government but the Chinese as a buffer.
Banyak orang berpendapat bahwa salah satu bahaya dari pos Soeharto ini atau pasca Soeharto ini adalah disintegrasi nasional. Itu memang dapat dimaklumi karena sistem sentralistik ini sangat bisa dikatakan sangat berdarah ya. Karena setiap protes atau keresahan dari daerah selalu diatasi dengan peluru, penyiksaan, penculikan, dan sebagainya, perkosaan bahkan.
Since Suharto's resignation, many atrocities of his regime have been brought to public attention. Many outer regional areas have been under military control for decades. The military are there to protect mining and business interests. Social disturbances often occur as people in these regions strive to gain some measure of independence. Like Suharto before him, and despite many apologies for the crimes of Suharto, Habibie maintains a large military presence in these regions.
Tetapi di Aceh, itu perkaranya selalu dengan stigmatisasi entah GPK atau GPL, garisan gerakan pengacau liar, selalu dengan istilah-istilah yang membosankan seperti memualkan seperti dilancarkan pada zaman PKI dahulu.
Since 1975, East Timor has been Indonesia's Achilles heel. This has been due to the passionate commitment of the East Timorese people inside East Timor, from those forced into exile and from left-wing and progressive activists around the world. Oil and natural resources are behind the 24-year occupation, which resulted in the systematic torture, violence, rape, mass killings, and starvation of the East Timorese population. Their crime is their desire to be an independent nation, and it has cost them over 200,000 lives, a third of the population.
Integrasi?
No!
Referendum?
Yes!
Sakarua, referendum?
Yes!
Independensia?
Yes!
Habibie has recently stated that East Timor could choose between autonomy or independence. But there has been no substantial withdrawal of Indonesian military forces. And there has been the arming of Timorese vigilantes in order to provoke a civil war if necessary.
Tidak sanggup!
Opposition to Suharto came from two broad areas, the moderate forces and the radical forces. The moderate forces had some legality under Suharto. They include three key figures. Megawati Sukarnoputri now has her own party, PDI Struggle. Abdurrahman Wahid, who heads Nahdlatul Ulama, which is the largest Muslim party in the country. The third group is the National Awakening Party, headed by Muslim leader Amin Rais.
Ya, ibarat kata, dia tidur saja dia jadi presiden. Saya ingin menggambarkan bagaimana popularitas dia. Dia tidur saja rakyat pilih dia.
Maka dalam kesempatan ini, saya dengan tulus dan ikhlas menyatakan ketidakberatan saya untuk memimpin negeri dan
with regard to Megawati, Gus Dur, and Amin Rais, we have to remember that for a long time, these people were close to the regime. Megawati, for example, was orbited, put into orbit by a section of the military. Gus Dur was close to another section, and as has been close actually to, for example, the Wiranto section of the military until now. Amin Rais was never too close to the military, but he was very close to Habibie. He was not acceptable to Suharto, but he was very close to Habibie. They have breakfast together from time to time. And also Amin Rais, for example, has clearly said that he might actually do a coalition with the ruling Golkar party. So clearly these are people who are the same, maybe a bit more democratic in their discourse, but we are afraid that when they get into power, the question is, can they control the military? If they cannot, they will just be puppets of the military.
Kalau Megawati jadi presiden, dia mengandalkan rehabilitasi ekonomi ini atas dana-dana IMF atau World Bank.
The radical wing of Indonesian politics has mobilized around the People's Democratic Party. In spite of having many of its leaders, including Budiman Sujamiko and Dito Sari in prison, the PRD played an important role in the downfall of Suharto.
Proses kelahiran pluralisme, gerakan demokrasi, PRD adalah the new emerging forces yang paling bisa kita andalkan.
For over 30 years, Indonesia's jails have been full of political prisoners. In 1996, Dito Sari was jailed for 5 years on charges of subversion against the state. Her crime was her success and popularity in organizing workers to fight for higher wages and better working conditions. In August 1998, a camera was smuggled into prison, and an interview with Dita was recorded under the noses of the prison guards.
The mobilization of the workers and the students together. Mm-hmm. And they know we can do that. And we already did that. Mm. Yeah, long ago. That's why they put us in jail. And that's why they didn't want to let us go. They are afraid that the stability of this country will be spoiled, yeah, by our demonstrations, by our mass mobilization. So they think that it's better to keep us in jail so that they can save their credibility outside without many problems or demonstrations from activists like us. So the simple word means they are afraid.
In December 1998, Dieter rejected an offer from Habibi of early release. The release offer came as a result of pressure being exerted by the worldwide campaign to free Dieter. Her release was conditional on agreeing not to engage in political activities until the year 2002.
And now Andi Arief is already free, and Jati is outside, and Wilson is outside. I feel so optimistic. You see, after they released Andi again, I think that, okay, they don't have to release me. Our hands, we have two hands. One hand is already out there. So, okay, if you want to. I thought I got released on 2001, yeah? 5 years in jail, I don't care. They will continue. They will keep on doing, yeah, what they should do outside.
Mengapa? Kalau saya jadi anggota PKI mengapa? So what? Mesti begitu. Kecuali kalau Bung nembak orang, itu ada pidananya, itu bisa dihukum. Tapi kalau Bung mempunyai pikiran Marxis, ya, bahkan kalau dalam soal PKI, menjadi anggota PKI yang waktu itu legal, mengapa? Salah.
Ada dua alat strum, yang pertama itu yang terasa di kulit, seperti kulit itu dibakar. Kemudian juga ada alat strum yang tidak berbunyi, tapi terasa seperti tulang itu dibor. Dan langsung apa namanya, darah itu membeku. Apa yang akan dilakukan PRD untuk ke depan? Mereka bilang, saya bilang kita akan terus berjuang untuk demokrasi dengan demonstrasi-demonstrasi. Tidak ada yang bisa kami percaya untuk demokrasi ini kecuali rakyat.
Karena itu saya justru mengharapkan angkatan muda yang mengganti seluruhnya dari warisan Orde Baru, seluruhnya. Saya harapkan juga mereka bisa menyingkirkan sampai begundalnya yang paling rendah pun, supaya disingkirkan.